project, program, and portfolio domains. And on the consulting space, we have served more than 50 different customers in deploying enterprise project management solutions using Microsoft and Oracle Primavera solutions. And our partners, PM4 NGOs. So PM4 NGOs is an international NGO that promotes and sustains the professionalism of program and project management in the international development sector. So in fact, the certification of Project DPRO and Program DPRO is from them. And we are also partnered with TPG Germany as a strategic partner. We support integration product and services between TPM and leading ERP solutions. We are also partnered with Intavar USA to give industry-aligned global best practices in risk management. So this is a small brief about ProVentures as such. So this is the profile of the speaker. So Mr. Srinivasan, I hope many of you know him. So he's the director for ProVentures with 38 years of industry experience. He has a BTech degree in chemical engineering from University of Madras and master degree in business administration. He's one among the selected professionals across the world who holds project, program, and portfolio management professional from PMI USA. He has also completed the certification levels with Project DPRO, the level 1 and level 2 certification during last December. And over the last 20 years, he has trained more than 12,000 professionals on different areas of project, program, and portfolio management. He's a lead certified assessor in the ISO 9000 quality management systems from BSI London, and he's a trained appraisal team member in SCAMPI CMMI appraisal. He holds the distinction of steering an ISO 9001 under CMMI level 5 implementation project from the grassroots level up to completion. So he's called as PS in the industry. So he is one of the founder director of PMI Pearl City chapter Hyderabad and served the chapter during 2001 to 2006. He's also consult companies on process maturity, portfolio and program management, risk management, and agile practice. So this is the brief profile about the speaker. And before moving on into the main section of webinar, so these are the few topics which we would like to inform our participants. So this webinar is going to be a two long hour session. So we just split into two parts. The first half will be a direct session from the speaker. So he will share his presentation. And the second half will be for question and answer session. So during the first half, all the participants will be on mute. And if at all you need to ask any specific question to the speaker, there are icons you can find in the participants window. So you can raise your hand and there are other icons which you can use to connect to us. So our person will be monitoring the chat window as well. So you can, if you want to write anything, you can write and we will be able to answer you back. And this webinar carries two PDUs. So after the webinar, we will be sharing our feedback form wherein you will have to mention your PMI ID. So we will go ahead and claim those two PDUs for you. And after the session, on request, the materials will be shared to all the participants. All right, so welcome you once again, and over to you, PS, sir.
Thank you, Ratna. Thank you. That introduction was about me was too much. And I just want to tell all of you that please, if you can identify and treat yourself, you treat me as your colleague, that is sufficient. Okay, I just want to identify myself as a practitioner of portfolio, project, and program management. Nothing more than that. Okay, are you able to see my screen now?
Yeah, we are able to see.
Okay, all right. I'll try to expand it. So I will skip this introduction, the first three slides, since she has already covered. And what you see on the screen is the cover page of this standard called PMD Pro. Currently, actually, it is called Project DPRO. Okay, Project DPRO stands for project management standard for development professionals. Okay, development professionals. You can ask what do you mean by development professionals? If we go into it, we can realize all of us are development professionals. Okay, so now I presume most of you here know about project management framework and methodologies. So as I scan through it, I could see at least 10 out of 14 are either trained by us or familiar to ProVentures. So I'm not really going into a 360 degree view of this particular standard. I'm going to pick up a selected seven topics within this and then share with you a brief about each of them. So these are the seven topics. Now these seven topics are different from the models that we are familiar with. Okay, some of you might be knowing about PMI's Project Management Body of Knowledge. Some of you may be knowing about PRINCE2 and a few other frameworks. So when I looked at these things, there are a lot of minor differences, but there are seven areas where, okay, there is a quantifiable, noticeable differences. Among them, the most I liked is benefit centricity. So that is why I titled it as a benefit centered project management, which you will see as part of point number three. Okay, project logical framework. Okay, which is very interesting. Okay, those who are passionate about project management methodologies, models, frameworks, philosophies, you will love to go through all of them. So I believe you are a few handpicked individuals who prefer to join us this evening. So feel free to raise your hands. And if you want to talk something about it, so we are just around 15. So maybe another 4 or 5 might join. We can have an interaction to that extent. Maybe towards the end of the session, our Q&A time may come down. Doesn't matter whether we do it in the beginning or at the end. At the end of the day, we all should know some of the nuances about this model. All right. So with this brief introduction, so let me go ahead with it. Okay. In between, I might ask some question. Don't get embarrassed. You can switch on, unmute yourself, and then you can answer it. Keep your answers very crisp, less than 1 minute, so that we keep up our time. Okay. Now, let me begin with a question. Okay, these guys have derived it as project management for development professionals. What they mean by development professionals is largely developing projects for social-centric initiatives. Okay, social-centric initiatives. So that means all the NGO projects and most of the government projects, okay, and a good amount of public sector initiatives and most of the CSR initiatives of corporates. Okay, all these things will fall in place. And now, is there anyone can give me one or two key differentiators between a for-profit projects and not-for-profit project initiatives? Okay, be crisp. Just about 2-3 differentiators between for-profit projects and not-for-profit projects. Any of you can mute yourself? Okay, I see Uma.
Yes, sir.
First coming up. Yes, Uma.
Yes, sir. In for-profit organizations, there will be like income and also like profit, income and outgoing and everything. But in non-profit, we will get the projects, we will implement for the people. So there will be no profits at all.
Okay.
There will be no, yeah.
Good. I think this is required because a lot of our corporate colleagues have joined. They all should know. Okay. The profits largely, okay, the project funding will meet the project expenses. Okay, not even for the assets. Okay, very limited way towards salaries. So there is no profit at the end of the day. Okay, any other differentiator? Anybody else can attempt? I think Suma raised up her hand.
Most of the projects for non-profit would not have a tangible result. It is more oriented towards the behavioral change or the behavior or other elements socially. They're non-tangible.
Fantastic. Okay. There may not be a tangible outcome seen at the end of the project. Okay. But at the same time, they are obligated to deliver results. Okay. Sometimes they may realize it 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years later, but still, okay, the project should orient towards those long-term intangible benefits. Okay, very good, excellent. So that's another big challenge. Any third challenge? Who would like to volunteer? Please raise up your hands. Premdas, would you like to answer the difference between for-profit and not-for-profit? Or anybody else?
So in non-profit, we also look at the participation of the beneficiaries.
Yes.
Rather than for-profit, it is just do the work and move on.
Excellent, excellent, beautiful. Okay, the stakeholder engagement, what in length we talk in corporate circle corridors, okay, truly should happen in not-for-profit. Otherwise, even the project outcome, we may not see it. Okay, unless you involve them right from the beginning till the end, they may not accept the outcome. Okay, the participation is essential. Okay, quickly, Premdas, 30 seconds. If you have any other point.
For-profit is a business-oriented, then the not-for-profit is service-oriented.
Okay, yeah. So a lot of service orientation involved. Okay, obviously there will be a product or deliverable orientation, but the service orientation is very high, and that service should be by and large very sacrificial, a selfless service, not only, I mean, by all stakeholders, the funding organization, implementers, the people who participate in development, the people who are beneficiaries. So everyone will work towards one common cause, okay, the service, okay, serving each other toward, at the end, serving the beneficiaries. So let me conclude it. It is not easy to do such projects. Okay. So now if your for-profit project management body of knowledge carries 600 pages, then your project management manual with these kind of challenges should be 6,000 pages. Okay. You can expect. Okay. Because that much of complexity is there, should be there. Okay, but very surprisingly, okay, this manual or the standard or the framework along with expositions, okay, is only 150 pages. Okay, because they felt that if we want to educate people from not for profit, it should be simple, concise, and very much user friendly. So they have developed it with 150 plus pages. Okay, that is what fascinated me when I looked at this standard. And to tell you the truth, I fell in love with it, okay, at first sight. Okay, so then we initiated that we would like to be partner with this foundation. And they had some initial questions that we always had only corporate sector projects. Can you do these things and all? So we have to do a bit of convincing. And they awarded that partnership to us. Okay, so we are the first Indian partner for PM for NGOs. In fact, they are open for many more partnerships to be established in India. I am counting one of the participants here. Uma is there in their board, Nirman. Okay, so if everything goes well, they also will become a partner soon. Okay, good. So let me get into it. Otherwise, we'll be losing time. So I'll take you through this seven differentiators one by one. And I may not have a lot of time to go through in depth. And we intend to roll out this through workshops in the coming months. Okay, so if you like it, if you want one day, if you want to be extensively involved in social projects as a volunteer, or even as a social entrepreneurs, or as part of your own organization's social initiatives, okay, feel free to take part in our in-depth workshops, get certified, and I'll tell you, you will get a lot of satisfaction, and really you will feel the benefit, and it will be a good PDU earning activity also. Okay. I might consider, where required, connecting with a case study. So this is the case study that I'm going to take it through. A Delta River project, which is also explained in the standard, where a river is polluted by human fecal discharges and also industry effluents. Okay, now because of that, the fishing activity is coming down, people are getting into lot of diseases, there is a economic growth is slipping. Okay, so how to stop this is the project. Okay, so that has been mapped to various the life cycle components. So I might use this. Okay. Later, feel free to ask for the presentation. We will send it to you. And then you can go in depth. I'll pick up the first one. Okay. They nicely present. Is the slide is fully readable, or this participant page is blocking you? Ratna?
It's readable, sir. You can
okay.
Yeah, so it's readable.
Okay. The participant page is only for me, correct?
Okay. Yes, sir. That will be only for you.
Okay. Thank you. And I'll push this and then place it.
But you can go on a presentation mode, sir. It is not on the presentation mode.
Yeah. Okay. You want me to do that? Okay. I'll try to do that.
I can just start slideshow from there.
All right. Yeah, so these are the five principles which you will find it not in other standards. So the first principle I'll take you, okay, it is every project should be well governed. Okay, so the project should have a governance framework for timely active decision making, articulating the roles, responsibilities, authorities, and the allowable approval or tolerance limits, and then the projects will go in the right direction. Okay, you can compare yourself with any type of projects. You will see that they are equally applicable, not just for NGO projects. Okay, the second principle is the project should have a adequate participation from the stakeholders across the life cycle of the project. Okay, that is one of the recipe for project success. Okay, how you do it at every stage, you need to work it out. The third principle, okay, quite often, this is actually valid for every project. In development project, it's all the more important. Okay, from identifying the project needs, designing the project, planning, and then implementing and closure, transition. Okay, so everywhere you need to have an adequate focus. Okay, quite often, okay, our focus is very skewed. Okay, we focus a lot in NGO projects for funding. Okay, in some commercial projects while planning. Okay, in some projects, they lose in the beginning sight and then do a firefighting a lot during implementation. Okay, so the focus should be uniform across the life cycle. So that is the principle of comprehensiveness. And then the fourth principle is integrated. So you'll see that this is the problem. Okay, okay. So if any project, if you take, there'll be hundreds of processes. Okay, if you look at PMI, there are 49 processes only to manage the project. If you look through the engineering processes, that will be another 60 to 100. Okay, so like that, everywhere there are hundreds of processes. Quite often in companies and foundations, they all work in silos. Okay, all these processes should not be operated in silos. They need to be tightly integrated. Okay, without which each one will, it is like a seven blind men trying to describe an elephant. Okay, so that is what will happen in a real-time project also. So that is the fifth principle, the principle of integration. And the sixth principle, there is no one solution, okay, for every project. Okay, so the projects are very dynamic, and the processes need to be tailored. Tools and techniques need to be selected appropriate to the needs, and the leadership, interpersonal, and various other soft skills also need to be very situational, and the project should be highly adaptive to the changing and evolving challenges, issues, changes, and the environmental changes. Okay, so I'm sure all of you will fully agree with these five principles. Okay, now how do we translate these principles into a ground reality and work with them? Okay, across the project is a big challenge. Okay, projects don't fail because of engineering deficiency or scientific inadequacy, okay, or any other industry practices. Projects often fail because of lack of project management capability. Okay, so many organizations don't pay attention to it, and they pay a heavy price in terms of time delays, cost overrun, not able to achieve the objectives that were set in. Okay, so this is something I would say 20% of the book, okay, is focusing on these five principles. Okay, that is the first differentiator. How these things are put in place, okay, in development projects. So it is very important, if you are from NGO, you should know how do we put these things in place. So the second differentiator, whenever we teach in ProVentures, we talk about this in length, but the standard do not explicitly talk about it. That is one reason The PMBOK was considered as a very heavy, and 2021 changes to PMP examination is predominantly from this arena. Okay, appreciating, understanding the art and the science characteristics of project management. So they are going to divide the domain itself into two parts. Okay, the process domain and the people domain and the environmental domain. And the art of project management is going to be elevated to 50%, okay, from the new PMBOK stream. Okay, so now here they explicitly place it. Okay, art of project management is all about human behavior, interactions, and the other related skills like leading, influencing, motivating, communicating. And then the science of project management is all about the hard skills in terms of estimating, planning, monitoring, controlling, okay, the various elements. Okay, so this is the second differentiator. And you would have seen in many of our workshops emphasizing this point, and you will see more and more in the coming days. The next element, Prashant, this is not moving forward smoothly. I click next, it is not going. I don't know why.
So maybe you can use your mouse to click on the screen.
Yeah, I think that is the important. So this is just to, they put this specific picture. Okay, what are the science element and art elements? And I think this audience is quite mature. You all know it. I will not overemphasize it. Okay, the third characteristic, okay, is the life cycle. Okay, so this is, I love it. Okay, so we have seen the life cycle picture. This is slightly different from what is documented in PMD Pro. It was not very catchy. So I asked my team to develop another infographic. So that came out well. The life cycle will look like this. These are the five principles that govern the projects. And the next is the life cycle. Okay, we'll go a little bit in detail each phase. Identification and design is the first phase. And then setup is the second phase. And planning, implementation is the third and fourth phase. And closure is the fifth phase. Okay. And there is a sixth phase. It doesn't come sequentially. Okay. It comes all covering all the above five phases. Okay. Which is called MEAL. MEAL. Monitoring, evaluation, accountability and learning. So these four principles, or rather these four activities, should cut through all the phases. You need to do them, okay, across the project life cycle. So this is very interesting, and I would say this is where this PMD Pro model encompasses both project as well as some of the PMI's program-centric elements. Okay, so in program management, we talk about program setup, program formulation. Okay, and when it comes to project, we talk about initiation. So that is actually merged with setup. Okay, the decision gate after setup is approved project charter and established project governance. Okay, so that is what you will see. And then you will also see that how the agile model also is built into it. Okay, so in development projects, without knowing, our good friends embrace a lot of agile practices. Okay, they go incrementally or they go adaptively. Okay, and they go in a hybrid way. So you will see in one life cycle, both incremental life cycle, adaptive life cycle, hybrid, predictive life cycle, and hybrid, everything is built into it. Okay. So that is what I like it. So the planning and implementation will go in an iterative mode depending upon the overall scope of the project and the nature and complexity of the project. As you do it, you do this monitoring, evaluation, accountability, and learning. Okay, I will go briefly later explaining some of these things. Since many of you are also my students in PMP program, I will not repeat any of the PMBOK aspects because you all know it. Okay. So maybe I'll just pause for a minute. Any of you, if you would like to ask any questions on the life cycle model, you can ask now. Good to continue? Okay, thank you. I'll go further. This is a quick overview in each phase. What is the differentiator? Okay, I'm not going to explain in detail. In the identification and design stage, okay, you basically do the need analysis and then find out the opportunities that are available, scan through the project environment, design various alternatives, and then define the project. Okay, you'll see the depth. In fact, among all the five phases, the most complex, difficult, detailed phase is the first phase, identification and design, because that is the amount of focus required in the development project, as we saw before. Okay, so it's a very, very challenging environment in which they will do the project with a very little knowledge about the domain, knowledge about the project management, and the key stakeholders will be a very, very heterogeneous in nature. Okay, so they spend a lot of time, and the outcome is, okay, the strategic and operational framework within which the project should operate. Okay, so it comes in the form of various elements, but one of the important element is the log frame, okay, the logical framework, which I will later explain it to you as another differentiator. So the second differentiator is second phase is setup. So here, as I was telling you before, the project is formally authorized. So that means you all know, okay, there is a there is a project charter developed, apart from which defines the overall parameters or benchmark for the project. And then it also establishes the high level project governance structure and framework. Okay, so that's the second phase. The third phase is like more like a PMBOK, okay, the planning process group, but they play a low key in terms of getting into nuts and bolts, okay, nitty-gritties. So most of it are done, scope, schedule, cost, resources, risk, okay. In fact, a few more are being added. You should have a meal plan, monitoring and evaluation and accountability and learning plan should be developed. You need to develop supply chain plan, okay, which includes logistics, asset management planning, etc. And also they need to develop a sustainable plan, sustainability, okay, because the project doesn't end. It is only transition to another phase or another operation. Okay, so all these plans are being developed, and these plans, as we know, progressively it is revisited in every cycle across the complete life cycle of the project. Okay, so that is the third phase. And the fourth phase, you all know, okay, more of directing and managing the implementation. It's a heavy piece, okay, where the leading the team, dealing with issues, managing, engaging stakeholders, okay, creatively integrating the different elements of the product and the project plans. Okay, so this will be done pretty much the same as we do as part of any other project. Okay. fourth phase, closure phase. This is very different. I will go actually in depth towards the end in terms of validation, confirming the deliverables with the beneficiaries. That is the challenge. Okay, it is not, there is no receiving organization. Okay, so they need to identify, transition, establish a sustainable framework, and then do that. All of them should be included part of the project. Okay, and a significant aspect is trust is given for lessons learned. Okay, it is not just a register updating. That's why this is added as part of MEAL. Okay, the learning is very, very important because they learn for the first time and they need to teach receiving organization beneficiaries. So not a lot of knowledge exchanges involved in such projects. Okay, and then as usual, administrative, financial, contractual closures are to be done. And these are very important because they need to answer every rupee spent on the project. Because you will see somebody is funding, somebody is implementing, somebody is at the field level coordinating and then delivering the services, and somebody else is receiving the benefit. Okay, so there's a lot of public accountability involved in this project. Okay, so these are the major life cycle phases and activities. And the fourth one that ties, or the sixth one that ties all of them is MEAL. So you'll see here, monitoring, evaluation, accountability, and learning. I'll discuss in a little bit in detail later what this evaluation, accountability, and learning, how it is being done, how it is different from our conventional FAR project endeavors. Okay. Any questions before I move on? How are we doing in terms of time? Okay. Not bad. 45 minutes have gone. Okay. Any questions? I would probably, if no questions, at least I would like to receive feedback from audience. It should not be just one-way traffic. If you have a question, raise your hand. If you have want to simply give a feedback, you give a feedback in terms of saying yes or raising up your hand or whatever it is. Give some signal. Oh, thank you, Prem Das. Others?
Yes, sorry, I have joined through web browser, so I don't have raise the hand option. Can I ask a question?
Yes, Abhishek.
Okay, so PS, just wanted to understand this MEAL thing. When you say accountability, means accountability seems to be more of a behavior, more of a principle, but it is introduced as an activity. Can you maybe help us understand, means how do you draw accountability as an activity?
Okay. Yeah, when they talk about accountability, they talk about transparency, okay, in terms of work, what you do, money, what you spend, all of them, asset, maintaining asset. So for everything, there should be a transparency, accountability. And third element is ethical dimension. Okay, how you are giving without any gender bias. So these things are very important. How you kind of impartial you are in your project. So those things are stressed when it comes to accountability, Abhishek.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think Mayur, you have anything to ask Mayur at this stage?
No, sir.
Good. All right. Thank you so much. I would have been happy if many of you raised up your thumb. or your this one. Okay, let's go ahead. I want to spend a little more time in terms of the first phase. I told you this is a big differentiator. In a traditional PMI model, we just put all these things as pre-project activities, and then project manager don't really pay any attention to those activities. Okay, whether it is not-for-profit or for-profit, those activities are very, very important for the project manager. Okay, so let me pay a little more attention into it. So this part deals with a need analysis, and then the project manager has to do with his stakeholders current state analysis and future state analysis. Okay, which you all know that as is to be. Okay, so here it is as is, and then there it is to be. So that is something, okay, to be done as part of this. Okay. Now, I'll go further. Many of you understand. But what I want you to, there are a lot of data analysis, some theories in terms of triangulating data, and then very, very fascinating things are there in terms of how do you do the need analysis. But after that, I just want you to want to focus on two things. Okay, one is problem tree and the objective tree or solution tree. Okay, for the corporate audience, I want to introduce this. Okay, as part of as is analysis, you need to do a root cause analysis. Okay, so you need to identify what is the core problem. Okay, now this is not just applicable only for NGOs and the government programs, it is also applicable for our for-profit projects. So we need to be sensitive of what is the problem we are going to solve for our customer. Okay, and that needs to be placed in the middle, and then you need to go upstream in terms of the causes for the problem. Okay, the root causes, and you all know we have the Ishikawa diagram, fishbone diagram. Okay, or okay, five whys, why. Okay, so you need to do that. Okay, so maybe I'll just read it for your understanding. Community members in the Delta River project are contributing to poor river water quality, okay, because of unhygienic practices such as dumping fecal waste into the river. And there is another problem, another tree you have to do for the industry. Okay, the industries are dumping their effluent into the river. Okay, so then you go to the root causes. Okay, so the tier one causes, and then you go to tier two causes. Tier one, the community is unaware of the dangers of dumping their wastewater, dumping the human waste into the river. Okay, our villagers, they really don't know. They may even think that it adds benefit to the river water, then that water flows to the fields, it is more fertile. Okay, so they don't have an awareness. The second cause, okay, there is no access to quality lettings in the Delta River community. Okay, there are a lot of communities around. Okay, the people don't have access to the quality lettings. That could be another cause. The third cause, poor household infrastructure prevents sewage systems from being installed into the household. Now, I'm sure if I connect to my own village, okay, all these three are true, okay, even today. Okay, because of Swachh Bharat, some improvements happened, but I would say still it is there. Okay, this is the first level. Okay, and then go to second level. Okay, why, you ask, why people are unaware of it? Okay, now the second thing, the community is culturally, okay, have certain myths around it. Okay, so that needs to be removed. Okay, the community is unaware of the consequences of this pollution. Okay, So you continue like that. Okay, now I guess you all of you are getting a crux of it. Okay, so you need to perform this problem tree. This is one iteration, one cycle. The second I cycle, take the same problem and then go to downstream. Okay, because of this problem, what are the consequences? Okay, you see first consequence, high incidence of waterborne diseases in the community. Second, okay, lower river water quality that affects the other ecosystem. Okay, that means fishing activity is coming down. Even the industry that puts the water into it, the downstream industries see that the water is not biologically good, physically good, etc. So there are a lot of downstream consequences. Okay, so this is the as is analysis to be done based on, and you shouldn't stop here, and you need to go to the next as part of to be, okay, what you need to do. Okay, are you with me, all of you? Okay, I'll continue. So here you need to bring a mirror image of it. Okay, there we put the problem in the center. Now we need to put the objective of the project in the center. Okay, what is our objective? What is that we are aiming at? Okay, now it's the problem what I narrated in the river water project, Delta River project is huge. Okay, as a small project, you can't solve every problem due to various factors. So you need to state the objective here. Improved access to wash facilities and increased knowledge in terms of best practices related to hygienic standard is the objective of our project. Okay, WASH stands for water, sanitation and hygiene. Okay, this is a global initiative, okay, to establish WASH facilities is our objective. Okay, and then you need to do the analysis. Okay, there we saw the root causes. Now, in order to achieve this objective, what are the means that we need to put in place? Okay, so increase the awareness. So it is a mirror of what you did. Okay, and then through this objective, what will be the end? Okay, the benefits and the very, very high level, okay, national level, state level, community level, okay, what will be the benefit that will be derived out of it? Okay, reduction in incidence of waterborne diseases, improved river water ecosystem. Okay, you will see it actually, it is easy to build this, but it needs a focused brainstorming with the key stakeholders. Okay, having done these two analyses, so then you need to move to the next step of, okay, designing the framework. Okay, designing the operational come strategic framework for the project. Okay, so the framework will have these four elements. What are the activities that we are going to do? And if we perform those activities, what are the outputs that we can expect? The tangible, non-tangible. Now with these outputs, we may have to do some more in terms of education, change management, okay, policy level changes, and other handholding through which they will get the outcome. Okay, outcome, what the project expects to achieve or accomplish at the beneficiary level, okay, to contribute to the population. Once the outcome is reached, you will see that the high level objectives, okay, in terms of transformation, okay, the community transformation, sustainability, livelihood, well-being of the people, okay, these are overarching goals, okay, that will be done. So you need to connect all these four layers, okay, when we design the framework. Okay, if you look at it, okay, the PMBOK is far behind in terms of, okay, this framework. When I speak about this comparison, don't think that I am against PMBOK. I am equally passionate about, okay, the project management body of knowledge. What I'm trying to say is there it is addressed in different layers. Okay, in order to get these four levels, okay, you need to be a certified business analyst, then certified project management professional, and certified program management professional. Okay, all of them you need to integrate to achieve this four level. But for a NGO or not for profit, they cannot afford, okay, that kind of investment effort and all. So they need to do that. Integrating these four elements, they need to define this framework. Okay, this is called log frame. Okay, the log frame will consist of four horizontal rows: activities, outputs, outcome, and goals, and four vertical columns. Okay, the description of each of the item, indicators that we call metrics in other framework, and then what are the means of verification, and then when you design it, what are all the assumptions that you assume or you take it for granted, okay, the considered as true. So these you can say 4x4, okay, 16 cell framework, we call it as a log frame. Okay, this log frame is the project design. Okay, so you will see at a different level different metrics to be drawn. Activity level, it is very easy. Okay, how many activities completed, how many milestones are done, measuring is easy. When it comes to output, relatively difficult. Okay, you need to measure in terms of deliverables, okay, outputs. Okay, and then outcome, the measurement is really difficult. Okay, so you need to first define, okay, what is the indicator? How do you measure it? You may have to do some survey. Okay, a lot of things need to be done. And then finally, you need to even go to define what are the indicators for the final goal or objective. Okay, so that could be even at the strategic level of the funding organization, like World Bank and other donor organization. So as a project team, you have to define this log frame that should be included in the proposal that you will submit to the donors, and then they will give the funding for your project. And then you need to work through it across the life cycle to meet these guidelines. Okay, so that is the part. So if you look at it, I have given some examples for the Delta River project. So activities, okay, you need to define specification for the lead teams, okay, and then you need to come up with the engineering drawings, work with the procurement team to do the purchase, and then do the construction activities in terms of lead teams and then lavatory caps, etc., and then subject it to a quality check. These are all the activities which you all know. Okay, very easy to measure in terms of time scale. And then output. Okay, how many quality latrines have been constructed? Okay, how many people, the people have been trained? Okay, have you created the the advocacies? Okay, to create awareness among the people. All these things are outputs. Okay, outcome, we need to see, okay, in terms of how are the people started going and using those latrines, okay, and what is their feedback, okay, satisfaction level. Okay, so this comes the outcome. Once you do that, the final goal is to demonstrate it in terms of improved river water quality and the fishing activity, economic growth. All these things will be the ultimate objectives of the organization. Okay, so you see here the layers. I really want our corporate PMPs, okay, to see, okay, how this framework looks like and how it is different from our traditional PMPs. Okay, any questions? I would like to pause for a moment. Or any of your feedback?
In the activities part, can we also include the kind of awareness programs we are giving to the community? Would that also come under the activities?
Yes, Suma. Okay, that has to be part of activities. Okay, and then those things should be output. You see here, municipality people trained, common public advocacy. So that will reflect. So everything should be defined from that bottom-up approach.
I have a small, like in this chat, how do we measure the success? Like, we don't have any, is there any specific place where we measure, where we stand with respect to our goal?
It has to be done, no? Say, right now it is defined, okay? As part of MEAL, okay, that needs to be measured. If you look at it, as part of implementation, activity level measurement will be very easy. At the end of project, output level will be easy. And then as you do further activities in terms of change management, the learnings, all those things, you know, advocacy activities, you will start measuring outcome. And then finally, you will measure in terms of the river water quality. Okay. Now, when we say this, right at the beginning, you may have to conduct survey. Okay. In terms of what is the current river water quality? What is the current aspect of in terms of how many people are using latrine? How many latrines are there? How many people are going in public? Okay. What is the quantum of industrial effluent being discharged? Okay, what is the current river water quality? So these are all the things you need to do a proper survey, set the base metrics as is, and then set the target metrics to be, and you need to design the project in order to achieve that to be state.
Okay, yeah, that's right. I think similarly, the retrospection also at output stage we may be doing.
It, exactly, at every stage, we need to do that retrospection, because if you look at it, I think I have one more slide. Okay. Yeah, this is the fully completed framework for the Delta River. Okay, I don't want to read it. You can go back and read it further. You'll see here at the activity level, the number of activities completed is the measurement. At the output level, training attendance sheet. Okay, and then the engineering survey data. At the outcome level, again, survey data, focus group discussion with the community and their feedback. And at the goal level, means of verification is water quality data test. So if you want to demonstrate the improvement, the same water quality test should be done at the initial level, assess level. Then you need to show that from this point to this point, this project made an improvement. Okay, so these are the indicators defined. And means of verification, and then you need to make assumption. Okay, those assumptions need to be translated to risk, and then you need to have a mitigation plan. If that assumption goes wrong, how do we, okay, mitigate those consequent risks?
Yeah, this slide is very clear. I think all my questions are answered here. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
Sir, in the previous slide, we can also have the health metrics involved in this?
Yeah, it has to be. It has to come. Okay? You may have to conduct some kind of health camp, yes, and then bring the data. So there's really a lot to do. Okay, if you read the standard, you will find out all those elements. Now, sometimes, no, the reality is you may not have money to do those kind of things. So then there is something called secondary data, primary data. So you need to go to do some literature survey, go to government or WHO, access the data, and then put it as part of your proposal. So these are the activities to be done as part of the identification stage. Make sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll carry on. I'll move from the initial identification stage to the next setup phase. Okay. I just limited to one slide just to tell you, okay, what are all the things that will take it forward. Okay. As part of the setup phase, the outcome is project charter. And you, by that time, you have to do a comprehensive risk analysis and then build that response plan and then give a risk register. And you should evolve a proper stakeholder engagement strategy. And the project launch, that is what I liked it very much. Okay. So the project should be launched, okay, with the associated stakeholders. Because everyone should know one such program is existing, and otherwise they'll become negative stakeholders for your project. Okay. And what are the activities or processes to be done? You see here, establish a governance framework, build the planning framework, meal framework. You will see all of them as strategy and framework. Okay. Later, you will translate it into plan. Okay, as part of planning stage, then those planning stage also, you will not do it like a comprehensive plan. It will be more of a stage oriented plan. Okay, so we know that already. Okay, in terms of the rolling wave planning is what we will do it. Okay, right. This is just to give you a way how the setup phase is done. And earlier, some people have asked me, what do we do as part of meal framework? Okay, I partially explained. Okay, now I'll take it to you to the couple of more slides here. Monitoring, we all know. Okay, you need to update the project plan, track the progress against the plan, and the log frame. Okay, that is very important. Okay, it is not just against activities and milestones. Against different metrics, activity level, output level, outcome level, and goal level. Okay, against the metric, you need to monitor, measure variances, identify and resolve risks and issues. Okay, all those things need to be monitored. So we all know issue log, risk register. Okay, those things are very familiar terms for us. When it comes to evaluation, okay, it is very important at different stages. The overall evaluation is very important. Okay. So we have seen it. Output, outcome, and goal. Okay. The collective evaluation needs to be done, because if activities are not done well, output will not be achieved. If outputs are not achieved, outcome will not happen. And if outcome doesn't happen, you will not achieve the overall objectives. So at every stage, overall evaluation is very important. Again, there are a couple of techniques, a dynamic in-process evaluation, and then the stage gate evaluation, and the final end time evaluation, something like that, and all are there. Okay. Accountability, I think Abhishek asked this question. Transparency, standardization, responsiveness, and participation. Okay, all these things should be built into it. Okay, you should have a meal plan. Okay, how you are going to do that activities, and then do that activities while implementation as well as closure. Okay, standardization is about compliance. Okay, how well your organization, okay, follows the set standards of the funding agency and the national, international requirements for an NGO to do. Okay, so there are a lot of NGOs who badly miss this part. Okay, the standardization. Responsiveness is very, very important. Okay, how do you respond to the stakeholders' engagement? Okay, and the other issues and other things, risks, how do you respond? And then participation. Okay, so now you will see all these four items are very, very important as part of the standardized the NGO projects. Obviously, they are very important. I won't discount our customer accountability project. Okay, they are equally important. And then finally, learning. Okay, the intentional learning throughout the project. Okay, particularly during implementation. It doesn't speak about the closure. Okay, particularly during implementation is very important. And the implementation is done in cycles. So that what you learn through hard mistakes, you should be able to quickly adapt in the next cycle, next village, or next increment. Okay, so these are called MEAL that you need to follow. I'll move on. If you have any questions, you can do that. One of that monitoring activity is changes. Okay, now this is another area where NGOs and others don't do well. Okay, how you systematically manage changes towards positive. Okay, and the other negative centric changes, you control them. Okay, so that's another important area. So I'll just, you all know that, this is an interesting loop, okay, which revolves around that accountability, okay, accountability and tolerance. Okay, for example, when you identify a change, okay, and then you see, is the project manager has the enough approval limit to implement, okay? Yes, means immediately go to log frame, budget, schedule, scope, and associated elements. Okay, perform a proper impact analysis. Okay, modify the plan. Okay, take it to the approval board. Okay, and then, okay, you implement. Okay, so I just brought a small subset. If the project manager does not have that authority, he may go to program manager. Is it within program manager's tolerance? If yes, then he will direct to modify the log frame, do the impact analysis, etc., submit for the plan. Okay, and then if that is, he don't have the tolerance, okay, there is a committee. Okay, we call it as a CCB or other board. Okay, take it to them. Sometimes even they don't have the authority. Communicate with the partner donor for initial approval, submit the amendment request, okay, with modified log frame, etc., and then finally you get the approval and modify the plan and then go and implement it. Okay, you see how this change loop is very comprehensive. Okay, sometimes we lack this clarity. So I thought it will be interesting for you to look through it. Okay, how changes needs to be brought into the project. Okay, so I will move on to the next step, or it is the last step. Okay, how do we close the project? Fairly simple, you all know. Now, the interesting thing what I liked here is, okay, these projects, no, there is no one scenario of closing. Okay, if you read through PMBOK, we'll say there are only two scenarios. A project completed very well or a project is terminated in between. In both the cases, you need to formally close the project. Okay, so now here you have a multiple scenarios, closing scenarios. The first scenario is the project is formally ends and all project activities are closed. So that means you are winding up, okay, that particular site or that particular project. Okay, the second scenario, I'm handing over the project. Okay, the continuation of the product or service out of the project will be handled through a local identified partner. It could be a national local NGO, international NGO, okay, or we may even transfer it to the government. Okay, sometimes it happens. Okay, they'll say that hand it over to the local village or administrative officer, he will handle it. Okay, that is the part. Then the closing itself will be very different. Okay, then you need to see there is an extension to this project. Okay, so the donor is very satisfied and they want you to take this project to another 10 villages or another state. Okay, so then the project will go on, okay, further. Sometimes it says it could be even at additional no cost basis. Okay, you will see some very strange. Okay, I want all corporate guys to know. Okay, an NGO is allotted, let's say about 20 lakhs for a project, and they say, hey, we could do this project in 15 lakhs. I have 5 lakhs in hand. Okay, so can we extend the benefit to another 5 more villages? Okay, you don't need any, we want no more money from you, but we want only a no cost extension for this project. Okay, they may agree and ask you to go ahead, or they may even ask you to return that 5 lakhs back to them, and they will say that we'll approve it through another initiative. So extension is another scenario. Expansion is another scenario. Okay, identification of elements for replication with the new target area and or new population center. Expansion. Okay, and redesign. Okay, based on the first tranche or the project, the whole project will be redesigned, and then with a modified one, there will be another intervention. Okay, so you need to understand what is the scenario, and then you need to go ahead and do activities accordingly. Okay, so now you will understand the meal plan. Okay, so as part of meal, and as part, at the time of execution itself, you need to develop the closure plan and sustainability plan depending upon the scenario, and then continue with the closure of the project. Okay, so that second differentiator is okay, how do you handle the lessons learned part? Okay, they have something called after action review. Okay, this is a lessons learned process only. So there, okay, they look at the two things, agreed on facts. Okay, there is no opinion here. What was supposed to happen, which is there as part of our log frame and plans, and what actually happened. Okay, the ground reality. So you assemble the facts. And then you share it with the stakeholders in terms of shared opinions. You brainstorm it. Why this difference is? So different stakeholders bring out with the different dimensions for the slip or deviation, etc. Okay, and then, okay, don't condemn, don't be a critic, negative critic. What can we learn from this? Okay, so do this after action review, and then do a proper documentation, sharing, and consolidation into the final report. Okay, so the evaluation we talked about is the final reporting, which we have to do time to time and at the end of the project. Okay, so we see that the meal is circled around the complete life cycle. Okay, so there is no specific moment to do these evaluations and other things. So this is overall, let me quickly look at my time. I think we have a good deal of time. So another 30, 40 minutes is there. So 30 minutes at least, we can have a healthy discussion. And before I hand it over for discussion, I would like to give you a little bit of certification that are available. Okay, so this is an exciting part for everyone. Okay, not only our NGOs, but also our corporate colleagues. Okay, so now this agency, okay, you can see only the logo here. You can reach out more into this link. PM for NGOs, it is about, I would say, a 15-year-old organization. And they've done a tremendous work during this short span. They, along with APMG, okay, many of you know APMG, they do hundreds of certifications in various areas. Among them, the Prince to Manage Successful Project, P3, Triple P, they're all project management related. Okay, so APMG is the partner who administer those credentials. So PM for NGOs plus APMG is bringing out these certifications. okay, on PMD Pro. So there are two levels in project, okay, L1 and L2. You all know, those who know PM framework, you know, okay, that it is equivalent to, you can say, CAPM and PMP. Okay, CAPM is more principle knowledge, framework level understanding. L2 is practitioner level. Okay, here also is the same. But now this L2 certification is going through a change. Okay, it is not just examination, but also you need to demonstrate some activities, what you have done in your area. Then you will get the L2 certification. Okay, L1 is currently active. L2 will be shortly activated. They said in about 3 to 6 months it will come back. Okay. I wrote both L1 and L2 last November, and that time it was only examination. Okay, currently L1 is available. L1 itself is tricky. Okay, we have couple of people who are getting ready to write a L1 examination 1 week from now. They are also participating. You can ask questions about it. They have taken some mock exams also. They also have taken a full-fledged training from us. Okay, so there is also a program level. Okay, they call it as a program D Pro. Okay, so after project, you can move to program level, where change management and all are part of it. So here, community level, org level, change management is not highly stressed, but highlighted. Okay, so that is there. 75 questions. 49 to qualify, no negative marks, pretty much like CAPM. And I can tell you, all certified PMPs, okay, you can attend a decent workshop or do a 2-3 weeks self-study and then go write the exam. Happily, you can pass L1. Okay, so this is a very exciting alternative for PMPs. Okay, to earn a credential plus something like 25 to 30 PDUs you can learn for one cycle. And the most exciting part is the examination cost is only $60 for for-profit organization and $22 for not-for-profit organizations. Okay, that's really, really attractive. And it's just equivalent to one meal for you. Okay, if you go to any decent restaurant. Okay, and still more interesting is all the material, okay, in terms of PowerPoint presentations, videos, and the standard itself, okay, are freely downloadable from this site. Okay, so where required application perspective and you don't have time for self-study, you can reach out to organization like us. We will do a systematic workshop, and then your cycle time for completing the certification will be short. Okay, if you go through a formal workshop. Otherwise, you can do it yourself. Absolutely no investment, no membership, no 5,000 rupees PMBA cost. Okay, you can freely download and then read out and then take this examination. Okay, so that is the part. And I'm done with all my PPTs. Okay, you can reach out to us. My ID is there, Vijay Prashant is there, Ratna is there. All of them are also attending this webinar. So you can shoot your questions. And I now open it for feedback, comments, and questions. Each of you, don't take too long. Maybe I can now give 1 to 2 minutes to share your background, your experience around this. Okay, don't take it out of context. And you can also post questions and we will try to answer. Questions will be answered by, we have some eminent people here. People like Uma and who is there? Mayur. Okay, great guys from BITS Pilani, doing nationwide NGO projects. Okay, you can put questions to them. And around the body of knowledge, K.V. Ramana has done good research and he is going to write an exam 2 weeks from now. He can step in to answer. And yeah, I wanted to not just I need to step in, others can also answer, okay, the questions to share your experience. I'll now open it. Okay, who is going to ask the first question?
Yeah, anyone can ask questions or share your feedback about the session, anything you want to share to know more about it, about the program certification part. How did you find the session?
If you are sharing about the program, please share, okay, your current practice and vis-a-vis how the standard expects and what kind of improvements you foresee within your organization. Okay, I want to be like that. Okay, so that it will be useful to all of us.
Who wants to go first?
Yeah, everybody is silent.
Hi, can I go?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, great.
So my name is Anand. Thanks for the session, MCPS. So I came across the PM for NGOs a couple of months back, and I've been postponing it to download the guide and start studying on it. This was definitely a good refresher to understand the concepts and everything. I'm looking forward, hopefully in a month, I'll be able to write the exam after doing some self-study. If not, I'll come back to you. So my background is mainly on climate and energy. So the last 7.5 to 8 years, I've been working on a specific focus to DRE projects and microgrids and street lighting in India and South Africa. So I mean, most of these projects have been successful, but did they achieve the goal part of it has always been a doubt because sometimes NGOs, sometimes our goals are very aspirational. When you want to create a societal change, reflecting it as a goal in a project or a program, it's sometimes very difficult to measure. So when you work from top to down approach on project planning or program planning, we kind of lose out on a lot of our metrics. So that has been my learning. I think I've been project managing for the last 3 years, and I've been a project implementer the previous 4 years. So I feel that this guide would kind of help me understand, relearn on how, what mistakes I've done and how I can go forth creating more sustainable projects for people on the ground, especially in the climate sector.
Mm. Okay. Good, Anand. Thanks for sharing. And yeah, the another thing what I'm expecting is we need to build a small community of practitioners. So I'm happy that you're going to take the exam. So do it. And then going forward, I'm intending to build a pool of trainers. So I also welcome you to be a volunteer as part of the faculty pool. Okay, so we will do. And the other things that are in our mind is translating PMD Pro into maybe Tamil, Hindi, Telugu versions. Okay, so we should do some great things for our country. Okay, so that, in fact, the chairman of PM for NGOs and the executive director, I talked to them and they said globally, currently, there are around 24,000 professionals are certified, okay, as any one of these certification. And he was telling, India alone is having close to 2 lakh NGOs, okay. So recently I read another article, of the 2 lakh NGOs, only 10% of the NGOs do a proper that we saw no the accountability, okay, in terms of registration, submitting the accounts to the Societies Act, etc., etc. So that means we can say 20,000 NGOs. So if each NGO trains one or two people, of that 20,000 complying NGOs, our Indian count alone will be more than 24,000. Okay, so that is what he was telling. There is a tremendous scope, unlike African countries where the funding organizations impose the NGOs to follow, okay, these guidelines. So that is why the numbers are high over there. So in India, we are all self-imposed trainers. Okay, we ourselves learn and then we start practicing. So that is why this is not prevalent. So we should work together to build the community. Okay?
Definitely, sir. Agree. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we all will be there to build this community with you, sir. I think it's pretty important that this bringing this professional standards to the NGO sector in India becomes very important.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Mayur. I think, Mayur, I want you not to just limit it to this 30 seconds. Okay. Just to give a couple of minutes intro about Nirman to the people who are here, and then what kind of parallel you can draw from this standard to your practice.
Sure. So, thank you, sir. Dear all, my name is Mayur Patnala. I currently serve as the founder and CEO of Nirman.org. It's a nonprofit organization which we founded with inspiration of Abdul Kalam and Swami Vivekananda and Mother Teresa in the time of 2005, when Abdul Kalam ji was speaking about Developed India 2020. Coincidentally, we are living in 2020 now. But in 2005, when we were at Bichplani, Rajasthan, we are not aware of NGO registration as well. So we were just intending to do something for the country. And we have started with as simple as saving 1 rupee per day for the nation and teaching 1 hour per day for the nation. So with that campaign, 200 of us came together at Bichplani, Rajasthan, and we went around the rural areas, have seen the utter poverty there and determined to do something for the country. And with that humble beginnings of teaching 1 hour per day and also 6,000 rupees, 200 into 30 rupees. Now, definitely after 15 years, by 2020, we have definitely made a good contribution where we could impact up to 1 million beneficiaries, that is 10 lakhs in 8 states of India. And after bits, many of us, including me, have gone to Europe and then came back to IBM in Hyderabad, and now devoting full time to Nirman with this noble work and trying to represent many volunteers. We have 300 employees and full time professionals, development professionals, and also 700 volunteers. I'm very happy to share that I have been me and my team, Uma, and many of us are associated with ProVentures from long time, and we have taken PMP course. And the first question that sir has asked us is, have you come here to for learning or certification? So when we told it is only learning, so that's when we started learning as well. And we have never worried about PMP, writing PMP certification, but we did practice the PMP fundamentals that are taught by ProVentures and Srinivasan sir. So it has been very helpful. And we are very happy that we execute in 8 states of India. We execute close to 82 projects last year. And this year we started implementing the fundamentals of project management into our organization. And very soon we are also going to start the technology part of it under the guidance of Srinivasan sir. And we are going to definitely contribute to the community that's being built here by ProVentures. So our time and effort is committed to this because we are all set for global goals. 2005 to 2020, 2020 is used to be for developed India, and now nirman.org, NIRMAN.org. Now we have focused ourselves for decade of action, that is global goals, quality education, gender equality, decent work and economic growth, climate action, etc. And now for going global impact, and we are worth of taking our projects to global, definitely to other countries as well. Because we, for example, the education helpline project that we have run here, and it is got selected as IBM Global Excellence Award, 20 countries applied and our project won. So definitely not only for profits, organizations which are starting from India, and we are able to take our projects to across the world. It is now part of the nonprofits, like all of us also have to innovate very good solutions from here, social innovations from India, and move it to various countries across the globe in underdeveloped and developing countries. For that to happen, I think this community, which is being proposed and built by Srinivasan sir and Proventus, I think that's going to play a crucial role for the next decade of action. The exact precise words that are used by United Nations for global goals, sustainable development goals I'm talking about. So all the best for the effort that we are going to put in building this community. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mayur. Okay. Suma, can you probably briefly introduce yourself to the people, and what is your reaction to this initiative or to this program?
Definitely, sir. So this is quite unexpected. I looked into it. I think it is at the last minute I've seen, and I just logged in. I didn't expect it to be so informative. In fact, I have been into the social sector from the last 10 years. I am into academics and into more onto the monitoring and evaluation aspect of these projects. And as you said, not many NGOs in our country go for this kind of accountability aspects. So when I was looking into the certification rings, I was more wondering, so do we have anything more into this monitoring and evaluation or impact kind of certifications rather than into the project management? Because I look more into those kind of concepts.
You're asking your question, Suma?
Yes, sir.
Can you be a little louder?
Am I audible now, sir?
A little better, yeah.
Yes.
What was your question? Can you rephrase it?
Yes, I was asking that this is more into the project implementation, and I am more into the monitoring, evaluation, and into the impact side of the concept. So, do we have any certifications which are related to that concept, sir?
Actually, this itself is very comprehensive. If you do that, you will realize that the monitoring part will significantly improve the moment you, because without a plan, you have nothing to monitor. Okay, so we saw the integrative nature of project management. So this plus the next step would be, how do we bring the digital drive, digital transformation? Okay, so that is where both combined together, you will see the projects will have a good monitoring. If the digital transformation is not there, assimilating huge volume of data, translating into meaningful information, and then showing it in the form of visual dashboards and reports, becomes difficult. So that's where what you are talking about monitoring needs a lot of improvement.
Yeah.
Okay, so to answer your question, understanding a comprehensive nature of these projects plus digital transformation together will help to monitor your project much better. So maybe offline you can call us, we can show it to you. How that can be brought into your kind of projects in terms of automation framework.
When I do an assessment or an evaluation, we also use statistical analysis. So we use some statistical data to derive at some facts and figures. So maybe this kind of certification would be of huge help down the lane into my line of profession. I will definitely get in touch regarding this. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Any further questions? Ram, would you like to share something?
Yeah, actually this topic is new to me, though some of the basic principles remain same, but the way you have explained, I think it's very well. It's in detail and the model also looks interesting and for a great cause actually. Though I was never aware that NGO organizations can implement, adopt this kind of thing and benefit. Yeah, it's quite interesting, but as I said, I have not exposed to this earlier, so that way it was interesting to hear all through. Maybe I'll go through the model in detail later and then get back with more feedback. But for now, the session is interesting, topic is good, and the way you explained also very well. I enjoyed it, definitely.
Okay, okay. So thank you. Thank you so much. And... good. Ramana?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I've been listening to the feedback given by various participants, especially from the NGO sector. Mr. I think his name is Nirman. And they were talking about this 17 sustainable development goals given by, mandated by UN, correct?
Yeah, Mayur?
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't notice the number, but...
yes, sir. Actually, if you can go to the website also, you can see there are 17 sustainable development goals given by UN. And they have target to complete them by 2030.
Okay, okay.
Srinivasan, sir, you asked me a question, so I'm sorry.
I'm just making my observations. Hello?
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Mayur, I think you spoke about this SDG of UN, 17 sustainable.
Yes, I have spoken about SDG of UN.
Yeah, correct. There are 17 goals, I believe.
17, yes, 17.
And what I understand is the target date given for completion is 2030.
Correct. A decade of action, 2020 to 2030.
30, okay. So what is the piece we have for in India?
All the 17 are for every country actually.
Okay.
So if you observe, so... basically, we could align our work to 6 of the 17 goals.
Okay. Okay.
Like quality education, no poverty, zero hunger, climate action, gender equality, decent work and economic growth, etc.
Mm.
But all 17 are applicable to all the countries.
Agreed. So, okay. So, you're prioritizing 6 out of 17 for India.
No, not for India. At nirman.org, that's what we are doing. 6.
Okay.
But till now we are able to execute projects and we have been executing projects in 6 areas out of 17 SDGs.
Okay. So any particular reason to choose those 6 are based on your capabilities or something like that?
It's natural that before these SDGs, we were doing education, we were doing gender equality, women empowerment. And so those are the areas wherever we were already doing, we aligned our work to the goals. So only okay. That.
So it's just only an extension of what you are doing earlier, correct?
That is right. And we'll definitely move on to other goals as well as we proceed. Yeah.
Okay. So considering the presentation given by PS sir, so what is the percentage of compliance you are having with the standard?
No, this is a standard which we are going to adopt.
We are going to adopt. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
So PMP... before PM for before project management for NGOs have come forward, which is the global standard now, which Srinivasan sir has first time has brought it to India.
Okay.
Before this, we our interaction with Srinivasan sir and ProVentures has been to we got trained on PMP.
Okay, I understand that. Okay. So, do you feel that some of them are implicitly being implemented, though you are not aware of the standard?
Probably, yes. I mean, once I go through this entire PMP PMP for NGOs training, then I think I'll be able to comment on that.
Okay. No, please don't think I'm questioning you or grilling you. Just I would like to know what are the practices being followed in an organization. That's with that.
No, very important. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Since I interacted with them a little more, I can, on behalf of Mayur, I'll respond. See, for example, when it comes to that compliance, transparency, okay? So you will see that they are impeccable, okay? But if somebody is asking, can you just demonstrate it, where is your dashboard, where is your benefit metrics and all. So then, they would not have followed the steps A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, but they reach H. Okay.
Okay. So
now when they are scaling up to national level and global level, so now their idea is, we need to streamline, otherwise a lot of overheads, like especially senior people, spending a lot of time in terms of data compilation, reporting, all those things comes up. They have to answer 10 people, same question. So that is where they are looking at how do they bring it into a system and automation focus.
Okay. All right. So, coming back to me, my name is K.V. Ramana. I'm currently working as consultant program management for one of the biotechnology companies biologically, and where we are more into setting up this manufacturing facilities, a fully qualified manufacturing facility ready to manufacture vaccines. So, that is the role I'm playing there. And we develop schedules, track them, interact with the various stakeholders, prepare some MIS reports and report back to the management, and make the teams aware of the risk factors, about the schedule deviations, and discuss with them on the aligning the schedule back to the original dates. So this is the role I'm currently playing there. So I had a chance to attend the training program, what PSR was saying. The initial training program we conducted in the month of June. So personally, I got fascinated with the log framework, where it is a very clear understanding how the outputs, how the activities contribute to the overall goal. So there is a linkage right from the bottom, the basic activities are the tasks what we perform in a project and how it is going to contribute to the overall attainment of the goal. So that is one of the factors fascinated me. And the time spent in the identification definition itself is a very huge one. How do we identify the needs? How do we translate them into a problem tree and develop an objective tree? The objective tree itself finally forms will be the basis of the scope for the execution. The overall framework defines the overall framework, defines the overall strategy for execution. So all this planning, identification is a very comprehensive thing. And the next one is set up where we identify all the stakeholders, right from the beneficiaries, how do we involve them? How do you develop the roles and responsibilities? Then we finally go into the planning. So if you look at the PIBOK, we say straight away, define the scope and jump into planning. But here, a lot of due diligence and a lot of groundwork is being done before even we land up onto the planning stage. So with all the due diligence and the time spent in the initial two phases, the identification, definition and setup, the planning becomes easier and the implementation becomes easier because everyone is clear about what needs to be delivered. And finally, the closure part. The closure part also, the lessons learned is also defined from the right from the identification and definition itself. All the factors are provisioned. How to till the closure of the project? How do we close the project? So the thought process happens right from the identification and definition stage itself. So it is not a new process or something new when we land up in the closure phase or AR, because that is experience what we follow. Where is the L&D document, people will say, at the end of the project? Nobody bothers to spare any time to draft that LL document in the initial stage. Oh, baad mein dekha jayega. That's the tendency people will have. And it's very important to have this this transition done so that the it is not ending with just implementing a project. It is with the how does the end user pursue the benefit of the project and who is going to sustain the project. The involvement of the sustainable partners, sustaining partners, is also equally important. All these things will be identified in the identification and definition stage so that there is a very comprehensive project life cycle what we have. So that is the factors what I observed in this standard. And the rest of the things are all the normal ones, the risk plan what you make, the procurement plan, the resource planning, the defining the RACI chart, identifying the stakeholders. I think the additional aspect is we need to identify the beneficiaries of the user team and get them involved in the right from the beginning itself. So these are all the few observations I have on the attending the session, and I look forward to complete my exam in another couple of weeks.
Okay.
So thanks from my side. Anything else you can ask me, sir?
Okay. Thank you, Ramana. Thank you so much. And maybe if I just to open it for anybody else who have not spoken, you can give your comments. Otherwise, I would ask Ratna to take over any
yes,
closing
sir.
Remarks. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So I have given the feedback link in the chat. So I request all the participants to attend that feedback and give your comments there about the webinar. So if not, like the next webinar will be on the 16th of July, for which we will communicate to you again with the topic and speaker and other details. All right, so if any of you wants to have a kind of material presentation, we will communicate to you separately through mail. All right?
Yeah, and I think the other dimension is in the month of August, we plan to do how many hours, sir, Ratna?
Yes, sir. I will just share, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the schedule for the month of August. So the program will start on the 12th of August, and it will go up to 31st. So we will have 9 sessions, 2 hours per session. So these are the dates. So the timings will be between 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. A virtual meeting, and it will be done through Zoom. And we will also give you the recording of the session for your preparation. So this will be the schedule for the upcoming workshop. Yes, sir.
Anything else?
That's all. So if they have submitted feedback, then we are good. So yeah. This is the QR code for the webinar link, the feedback form link. So if you can't access the link there, you can scan the QR code.
This workshop, what we plan to do, we will help the participants in terms of examination, enrollment, and facilitation. And for NGOs, we actually have a discounted price of 7,500 plus tax. Okay. So I think who are all there? Our Nirman colleagues are there. Anand is there. Anand, if you have any of your partner organizations, if you would like to encourage them to participate, please feel free to write to us. And then Suma, if you know any NGOs you can communicate, you can be in touch with Ratna for doing that. And yeah, I think our others and all are known to us. So that's something we want to communicate to all of you.
Yes, sir.